We have a great vote of thanks for Jeff and Sabrina, who go through all the effort and details of putting on this wonderful expo every year. To just let you know how absolutely organized they are, I found out about 7 minutes ago that I was going to introduce Neil. So I was handed a piece of paper, and this is all about Neil's life and where he was born. He was born in Fargo, North Dakota. But more importantly, two nights ago, Neil was in Austin, Texas, and he drew a crowd of over 300 people at a running shoe dispensary. And he was introduced by Richard Van Esselstyn, my son. So, Neil, you are on a roll. I've had the privilege of knowing Neil Barnard probably about 15 years, and it's absolutely so exciting every time I get a call from Neil about some project or some concept that has to do with the healthy lifestyle. And no matter what's going on, I really put down whatever I'm doing because I'd like to do what I can to try to help PCRM, of which he has been the president of since he was 15 years old. But it's a remarkable organization, and it's a testimony to, I think, the vision that Neil has and the leadership that he has and the interpersonal skills that he has, the way he can bring together a group of people who have a shared vision and a bond in trying to achieve the goal of better health for all who really will pay attention and will get that message. But he's done this really not only from the research standpoint, he's been an author many times of books, and I'm just would have to say that despite all of his tremendous intellectual capacity, he has unbelievable courage because he has taken on the government and he has shown others that this is the way to do it. And I think that his example in being courageous is so very, very important when, let's just say that certain industries do not always have our best interests in mind. Now, the remarkable thing is that despite all these wonderful qualities that Neil has, when you're working with Neil, it's an absolute joy. Ladies and gentlemen, our distinguished speaker this evening, Dr. Neil Barnard.
Thank you, Russ. It's a pleasure to be here. Now, I have to confess, I was not the kid in the back of the room who knew how to run the projector, so I'm going to see if I... There we go. I wanted to talk tonight about some of the research studies that have come out recently that really have, in my view, shown us what a healthful diet is and also reaffirmed an awful lot of what many of us have thought and helped us turn some new corners. I want to start, though, with some research that's not so new. And if we can go ahead and go to PowerPoint. You remember, this is back 1990, Dean Ornish's research, and I know Dean has spoken here about his work. And I wanted to just go back to the study that really put his work on the map and then talk about his new work. Back in 1990 in The Lancet, he published his study, which was a randomized trial of patients who already had heart disease, and they came in to the study to test what he would call a comprehensive lifestyle intervention versus the usual care. And what that means is you either went on a vegetarian diet, and these were not people to whom this meant anything going in, they just didn't want to have a heart attack or have another heart attack, a half hour walk every day or an hour three times a week if that was more convenient, try to manage stress, which is why he didn't do the study in Washington, where I live, and avoid tobacco. And that was the whole thing. There was no angioplasty, no bypass surgery, not even cholesterol-lowering drugs, nothing, just these simple interventions. And they compared them to a group of people going to their regular doctors, taking drugs if that was deemed appropriate. And then after a year, if you looked at the cholesterol levels, the people on the vegetarian regimen, their cholesterol dropped 24% as compared to about 5% in the controls. LDL, you know what this is, bad cholesterol, low density lipoprotein, 37% drop. Their weight dropped 22 pounds, and that's what got their attention. It wasn't the fact they were going to live, it was that they would look healthier. And their heart disease started reversing so much that at the end of a year's time, you could see a measurable difference on angiogram in 82% of patients. And this, again, no surgery, no angioplasty, nothing, no, none of the surgical roto-rooters, not even cholesterol-lowering drugs. And this is why he used a vegetarian diet. The very leanest beef is about 29% fat as a percentage of calories. The leanest chicken, maybe 23%. Fish vary. Some are lower, some are higher. But there isn't any such thing as a fat-free fish. And in fact, you hear a lot of people saying, well, I eat fish now for all those good fat. Well, you wear that good fat on your thighs and on your waistline. And there is about 15 to 30% of the fat in fish is plain old saturated fat. So Dean took all of those out of the diet, and he focused on the power foods, the broccoli and the beans and rice and potatoes, the vegetarian foods. And this is his new study. Did you hear about this? Men with prostate cancer? This was just in the news recently. I don't know if you heard about this or not. 49 people with prostate cancer who were able to wait. They didn't have to have surgery right away. And they were assigned to the control group, and 44 were assigned to a vegan diet. Why? Because the diet doesn't only cause weight loss. It doesn't only reduce your cholesterol. It also brings hormones into better balance. And that's true for men, and it's true for women. At the end of a year, how many people needed cancer treatment, meaning they couldn't wait anymore? 6 in the control group, none in the vegan group. And so out of 93 men with prostate cancer, at the bottom is the prostate-specific antigen. This is a blood test that tracks how the prostate cancer is doing. And it rose, which it normally does as the cancer progresses, in the control patients, in the people who were not treated with the diet regimen. But it fell on average in the vegans. And he then took prostate cancer cells, which you can actually buy off the shelf at a medical supply, and you then mix the serum with them, serum from patients, mix them with cells to see the effect on the cell lines. And you look for inhibition. It's a standard assay. And it was clear that the men eating these vegan foods, not only were they doing well, but you could actually show in their blood anti-cancer properties that would inhibit the growth of cells in the test tube. Now, I was impressed with that, and I want to walk you through a study that I began a number of years ago. I was sitting at my desk, and the phone rang, and it was a young woman said, "Dr. Barnard, my mother told me I should call you. I can't get out of bed." I said, "Well, what's the problem?" "I've just got such bad cramps, and this happens about every month. I am so bad, I take all this ibuprofen, I just can't function, and my mother told me that I should ask you for a prescription for Demerol so that I could get on with my life." I said, "Well, that's a pretty strong drug. I can give you some painkillers for a couple of days." But as she was describing her condition, which was basic menstrual cramps, except that about 1 in 10 women has them so severely that they really interfere with their ability to get along with life, I started thinking about these relationships. We've known for a long period of time that hormones are affected by diet, and the reason we care about this is particularly because of breast cancer. The more fat in a woman's body, the more in her diet, the more her body makes estrogen. And estrogen is the female sex hormone really responsible for making things grow. You know about on a livestock operation, they'll put a little estrogen behind the steer's ear and it causes the animal to grow. Well, if you have more estrogen in the bloodstream, it can cause cancer cells to grow as well. Now, normally, estrogen is responsible for breast development at puberty, and cancer researchers have been very concerned about estrogen because if you have too much of it, cancer cells spread. Cancer cells can metastasize. But as she was describing this, I thought, you know what's happening is the lining of her uterus is thickening up every single month. And this is a woman's hormonal function in the course of a month. At the beginning of the month, she has very little estrogen. It rises to a peak and then it falls. That's about 2 weeks into her cycle, and she's now ovulating. And then you have this second peak that's there because the uterus is the most optimistic organ in the body. It is convinced we're going to get pregnant this month for sure. So you have this rise of estrogen because the uterine lining is going to thicken up because undoubtedly a little baby is going to come along and want to adhere there and grow. But as you can see, about a week before the end of the month, the disappointed uterus discovers that we're not pregnant again, and the amount of estrogen falls, and the uterine lining sloughs off, and that's menstrual flow. And as this happens, the uterine lining sloughs off. It releases maladjusted chemicals called prostaglandins that cause cramping. They cause headaches. It makes you feel crummy. And as she was talking, I started thinking, you know, I'll bet you she's got too much estrogenic activity, too much uterine thickening. Let's put her on a low-fat diet. Let's stop this from happening, because you can do it. If you go on a low-fat diet, the whole curve gets pushed down. If you go on a high-fat diet, French fries and cheese and fried chicken, that whole curve goes up. Too much estrogen. Are you with me? You get what I'm saying? Too much estrogen, too much uterine thickening, too much breast cancer risk, all of the problems you get with too much hormonal stimulation. Just as the men with prostate cancer need less fat in their diet, more fiber to calm down testosterone, which fuels prostate cancer, for women, the analogous situation involves estrogen. Okay, so I say to this young woman, let me give you some painkillers for a couple days. But let's try an experiment. For the next 4 weeks, no animal products at all. And if I'm on a diet with no animal products, how much animal fat is there in the diet? None. And let's also keep the vegetable oils low. No potato chips, no French fries, no salad oils. She said, I'll try anything. She called me back a month later. And she said, Dr. Barnett, I've got a question for you. I said, what is it? Why don't doctors talk to patients about this? Why don't people tell, you know, so many women are taking fistfuls of ibuprofen for things that can be treated to a large degree by taking care of the problem. So I did a study with Georgetown University where we brought in 33 young women, and we did what we call a crossover trial. That means you do one condition and then cross over to the other. One condition was a low-fat vegan diet, followed for two cycles. The other condition was we gave them a supplement, which said it was a nutrient supplement that could be either a vitamin or a placebo. And it turned out it was 2 micrograms of B12, which is in effect a placebo. And what we found, the first thing I found is that placebos are wildly overrated. These women, in taking this thing that they thought was going to be a miracle vitamin cure, did nothing for them. But in the two cycles on the vegan diet, their pain duration fell from not quite 4 days to just over 2.5. But the amount of pain they had each day was greatly reduced. So instead of being tremendously bothered by it and having to take huge amounts of medication, they could get through life and be fine. And their PMS got better as well. And then we also tracked their cholesterol levels. Now these are young women, healthy women, and mostly thin. And their average cholesterol going into the study was 163. And on the placebo phase, nothing happens. But on a vegetarian phase, they dropped 22 points off their cholesterol level, and that was in 5 weeks' time. They also lost weight, and they lost 5.5 pounds on the vegan diet, and they lost 2 pounds on the placebo. Any guesses as to why that was? Okay, so it was because they know they're being watched, they know that we're watched, and there's a mental effect that it might be doing something. I'll tell you what I think was the reason. Some of the women had the placebo phase first, then they went vegan. But the other half of the women had the vegan diet first, and then they went to the placebo, or what we called the supplement. We told them that to have a proper test, they had to go back to the diet that they had been on at the beginning. Well, as you can imagine, if you've had two cycles feeling good, losing weight, and your energy is better, most of the women refused to do it. So we said, you're ruining our research. You have to go back to the diet you were on before. Some of them did a little bit, some of them didn't, but they kept losing weight even during that phase. Okay, so we followed this up with a study in older women. These were all women after menopause, all with moderate to severe weight problems. It was 59 women, and they were randomly assigned to either a low-fat vegan diet or what we would call a step two diet. And I'm just talking about these typical cholesterol-lowering diets that are prescribed by the American Heart Association and similar organizations. Step one is not so rigorous. Step two is, in their definition, somewhat more rigorous, no more than 6 ounces of meat per day and reducing fat to 30%. But that was our control group. The experimental group was vegan and low fat. We didn't let anybody exercise any more than they were doing at the beginning because we wanted to isolate the effect of diet, and we tracked them for 14 weeks. And first of all, everybody's calories fall. Now, you kind of expected that with the control diet, but why would their calories fall in the vegan diet? They had no portion limit, no calorie limit, no calorie counting, no nothing. Well, the reason is just the foods you're eating are high in fiber, high in carbohydrate. Carbohydrate has 4 calories in a gram. And they're so low in fat, there's no cheese, there's no chicken, there's no salmon, and fats have 9 calories in a gram, that's all gone, so their calorie intake drops even without them being aware of it. So both groups reduced their fat. The green line is the vegans, the red is the control group. And the vegans did better at lowering their fat, as you can imagine. And the vegans' carbohydrate intake went way up. It dropped in the other group, but it went up. And as you can imagine, people are afraid of that. I'm eating more carbohydrate. You know, you've heard so much bad press about carbohydrate. Well, I want to tell you, we said, eat all the carbs you want. It's vegan, it's low fat, but you can have rice and potatoes and all day long. Now, let me just walk you through the findings real quickly. The first set of bars, the green bar going way down, is weight loss. That's kilograms. It's about 6 kilograms of weight loss in the vegan group. That's 13 pounds in 14 weeks with no exercise, no calorie counting, no portion size limits. The purple bar right next to it is the control group. They lost about 8 pounds. Then the second one is their body mass index. It fell again more in the vegans. The third set of bars is their body fat change, their waist circumference. All of these things fell more in the vegan group than in the comparison group. But you see that thing way out on the right? That thing blipping up? What's that? It's called the thermic effect of food. We brought everybody into the lab at GW, and we laid them out on a table. We put a mask on their face, and what we're measuring is their oxygen intake and how much carbon dioxide they're breathing out, because that correlates with your resting metabolism, how fast your body is burning calories. So everybody lay on the table, we put the mask on, we're measuring their oxygen consumption so I can tell you what your metabolism is. You know, many people with weight problems say, I've got a slow metabolism. Well, I can tell you. We then gave them all a test meal, and it was one of these liquid, like Ensure, only it's called Boost. You know what I'm talking about? And I'm not necessarily recommending this. We used this simply as a test meal for everyone, got exactly the same thing. Gave them 2 cans of it, 720 calories. They drink it down, and then the mask goes on again, and I measure their calorie burning speed. And after a meal, you burn calories faster. This always happens after meals because your body is digesting. It's absorbing nutrients. The nutrients are going into the cells. Some of it is being burned as heat and goes off as body heat. But what we found was that after 14 weeks, everyone went back into the laboratory again. They lay down again. We put on the mask. We assessed their calorie burning speed, and we gave them exactly the same meal at the end as the beginning. And it turned out that their calorie burning speed increased if they had been on a vegan diet for 14 weeks. And it did not increase if they had not been on that diet. You see what I'm saying? Just by having been on this diet, even eating the same foods at the test session as before, their ability to burn them off was dramatically increased. So I wanted to know, why is that? So we sent everybody to the laboratory again for the most thankless test. We made them consume 75 grams of pure glucose. It's a glucose tolerance test. It's this icky syrup. You swallow it down, and then I stick a needle in their arm every half hour. We measure their glucose levels and their insulin levels, and from that, what you're measuring is their insulin sensitivity. Simply put, it's how readily does glucose or other nutrients enter into the cells of the body. And if it can enter into the cell, it can be burned. If it doesn't, it just circulates around in the blood over and over and over again. So the first two bars are the before and after within the vegan group, and the next two bars are the control group. And in the first two, that's a significant increase. So here's what was going on. There's something about this diet that causes the cells to more readily take in the nutrients that are ingested. They go in faster, they burn faster, and you give off more of that as body heat, less is available to go to body fat. Now, it's a small change, it's a small difference, but it's about 3 hours after breakfast. It's another 3 hours after lunch. It's another 3 hours after dinner of increased calorie burning speed. And you put that together, and statistically, it's an increased part of, or it's part of the increased weight loss that we saw with this group. So the real reason that people lose weight on a vegan diet is that the foods are naturally filling. They're high in fiber, you fill up, and they're low in fat. They're naturally low in calories. But you get this added edge. Your body is different, and you know it's true. It feels different. You have more energy, and your cells are burning calories more efficiently. Well, now, if my insulin sensitivity is better, maybe this is a good diet if I've got diabetes. So we did a small trial in individuals, and this was just a pilot study first. Individuals who have type 2 diabetes, you know what I'm talking about, the adult onset? This is the one that you now see in kids. It used to be you had to be 40 to have this disease. Adult onset diabetes, type 2. Now we see it in kids in high school. Why? Because kids in high school have a greater incidence of obesity. They're eating worse foods than before. Anyway, we brought in individuals with type 2 diabetes. These were all adults, and our first study was very small. It was six people in the ADA group and four in the vegan group. Two of the people in the ADA group dropped out. The ADA is the American Diabetes Association, and they encourage a diet that's a sensible diet. It says, if you have diabetes, the problem is you can't handle sugar. You eat sugar, and it gets into your bloodstream, or you eat bread or potatoes, some starchy food that digests into sugar. That gets into your bloodstream. And the sugar normally should then go into the cells to be used. Glucose, simple sugar, is the rocket fuel for your muscles. But if you have diabetes, it's not getting in. The glucose circulates in the blood over and over and over again. Eventually it gets in, but it takes a long time, and the level of sugar builds up in the blood. And eventually it actually filters from the bloodstream through the kidneys into the urine. And it carries water with it. And so people find, before they've been diagnosed, they're going to the bathroom all the time, and because they're urinating, they get thirsty, and they go to the doctor's office, they say, I've got no energy. I'm urinating all the time, I'm constantly thirsty. The doctor knows instantly, you've got no energy because glucose is not getting into the cells of your body. Instead, it's going through the kidneys into the urine, that's why you're urinating a lot, and because you're losing water, you're drinking a lot, this is diabetes. We put people on the ADA diet, and four of them were on oral medications at the beginning, and six of our seven vegans were on oral medications at the beginning. No, these were not vegans to start with. These were the diets they were assigned to. And in the course of a 12-week trial, none of the people on the ADA diet could get off of their medicines or reduce it. But four of the six vegans needed a dose reduction in 12 weeks' time. Two of the vegans were on insulin. Both of them needed a dose reduction. And they lost weight. Once again, the ADA people lost about 8 pounds, which is what you expect, because they're put on a 500-calorie per day calorie deficit to try to burn the weight off them. The vegans had no calorie deficit, no calorie limit at all, no limit on carbs or portion size, and they lost 16 pounds in 12 weeks. And their blood sugars fell very nicely, 28%. For any doctors in the crowd, this is hemoglobin A1C. It dropped somewhat more in the vegan group. Keep in mind they're on less and less medicine, but the diet is still better for them. And their this will not be on the test. Urinary albumin as a function indicates your kidney function, and that got better too. So we're now doing a study funded by the National Institutes of Health on the same kind of diet in individuals with type 2 diabetes, and it's done by the PCRM along with the George Washington University School of Medicine and the University of Toronto. And we're funded by NIDDK at the NIH. And this is our team. Folks from GW and the University of Toronto. And We have 99 people, all of whom responded to an ad in the paper. I don't put ads in the part of the newspaper where it says, you want to be in a research study, we'll pay you $100. Our people get paid nothing. I put the ads in the movie section or the style section. I want just run-of-the-mill folks who don't want to have diabetes, and they read about this, and they come and they join our studies. 99 people, and we're comparing two diets. One is a low-fat vegan diet. That's our experimental diet. The other is a diet following the ADA guidelines. And what we're tracking is this measure of blood glucose. It's called hemoglobin A1C. It's 22 weeks and a one-year follow-up. 70 people started it in 2003. 29 more started in 2004. Our results are coming out next year. Stay tuned. I want to talk about a study that's done by David Jenkins, who is working with us on our diabetes study. He developed what he calls the portfolio diet. A portfolio diet is a portfolio of dietary changes. And what he said was, if a vegetarian diet will lower cholesterol, which it does, and if what he would call viscous fiber, that means soluble fiber like oats or barley, if that lowers cholesterol, and if soy will lower cholesterol, which it will, and if almonds and other nuts will lower cholesterol, and if certain plant sterols will lower cholesterol, what happens if we take them all at the same time? So he did a four-week trial with three groups. One group got just a more moderate low-fat diet. That's your control group for comparison. The next group got that same diet along with lovastatin, a cholesterol-lowering drug. But then the third group didn't get any drug. They just got this vegetarian portfolio diet. And the low-fat diet, the control diet, their LDL, bad cholesterol, it dropped about 8%. The people on the low-fat diet plus the cholesterol-lowering drug, their cholesterol dropped about 31%, which is good. But look at those vegetarians, no drugs at all, and their cholesterol dropped almost the same as those who got the prescription. Here's my point. Dietary changes are first-line treatments. The patient comes in with high blood pressure. The prescription should be a diet change. The person comes in with a cholesterol problem, or they come in with a weight issue. The first line of treatment should be diet. Medications and surgery are alternatives. Medication is a complementary medicine, if you will. We hear it the reverse, don't we? Your prescription first, and if that doesn't work, we might try diet. Should be exactly the opposite. We should address the cause, and that's diet. This was the New York Times Magazine. People find this, and they salivate over it. And some of my own research subjects would say, you know, I wake up at 4:30 in the morning dreaming of cheese pizza. Or sometimes people get hooked on these things, too. These are cultural problems. Well, what's going on? This is what's going on. This is Narcan. This is a drug. We use it in emergency rooms. It's used in cases of heroin overdose. A guy shoots up on the street, and he misjudges his dose. And he gets wobbly, and he falls down face first in the gutter, and his friends know exactly what's going on. They know he is going to die. So they grab him, and they bring him into the emergency room, and what you do is you take his arm, you put a tourniquet around it, you pop up a vein, you knock the top off that bottle, suck it up into a syringe, jab it into his arm, and the Narcan goes to his brain, and it coats the opiate receptors so that heroin no longer is effective. And he gradually wakes up, and you've saved his life. I can give that very same drug to a chocolate addict. I don't mean a person who likes chocolate. I mean a person who is inhaling chocolate. And the most amazing thing happens. You give them a tray, and they'll take a little taste, and they'll say, oh, thanks, that's nice. Have some more. No, don't really feel like it. Go ahead. No, I don't really. Chocolate is not a food. Chocolate is a drug. And I don't mean to say it's necessarily a terribly powerful one or not even a terribly bad one. But you know, if you're a chocolate lover, you know you don't like chocolate. You know you need chocolate. Am I right? You never went to the 7-Eleven at 9 o'clock at night for cauliflower, did you? The taste of chocolate on the tongue triggers a nerve reaction in the brain, releasing opiates into the brain. And if it didn't do that, no one would ever go after this bean extract we call chocolate. And other foods do the same thing. Sugar will do this, but particularly if sugar is mixed with fat, which is why nobody took a box of Domino sugar and a spoon and made dinner. But if we mix it up with margarine or butter and bake cookies, then you can have sugar-fat mixtures all day long because they trigger an opiate release in the brain also that I can block with Narcan. But do you know about casomorphins? Some years ago, I was wondering why was it that my new vegans would often look lovingly at cheese, not yogurt, not milk, not even ice cream, but cheese was the, do you know what I'm talking about? Do you have friends who, well, I went vegan, but man, I would really kill for, you know, like a good vegan cheese. Listen, it smells like old socks. Why do people want this stuff? Here's why. Any protein, it can be a dairy protein, it can be meat protein, any kind of protein, it's a string of beads. Each bead is an amino acid, and in your digestive tract, the beads come apart. The amino acids come apart. They enter your digestive tract, they go into the bloodstream, and they're used by the body to build skin and organs and hormones and various things that protein is used for. Except for the milk protein. It doesn't behave that way. You know the milk protein, casein? This is the vexation for every vegan. You find it as the 22nd thing on the label that rules that food out. Casein is the dairy protein. Like other proteins, it's a long string of beads, but when it gets into your stomach or into the calf's stomach, it does not break into individual amino acids. It breaks into small strings of 4 or 5 or 7 amino acids, 4 or 5 or 7 beads. Those get into the bloodstream. And here they are. This will be on the test. There are the molecular formula is on the right. These are all narcotics. These are called casein-derived morphine-like substances. They're very mild. They're not strong. The strongest one is called morphiseptin. There, it's about 1/10 the power of pure morphine. Why are they there? Why would milk have narcotic chemicals in it, albeit mild ones? I'm going to tell you why I believe they're there. It's because nature doesn't like leaving anything to chance. If the calf nurses and gets protein and gets lactose sugar for energy and gets fat and gets hormones and gets various other growth promoters, but doesn't enjoy this experience, the calf is likely to say, hey, Mom, I think I'm going to go wander in the woods. I'll see you next Wednesday. And that calf is going to perish. But the calf nurses from mom, and along with all those nutrients come this very small drug effect. If you've ever looked at the face of a nursing baby, they get the goofiest expression. And then after they nurse, they collapse into this deep sleep. And we think the mother-infant bond is this wonderful thing. My lullabies and cooing are so effective. Listen, you just drugged the kid. That's all there is to it. Human mothers have casomorphins too, and it's there. I hate to be so unromantic, but the mother-infant bond does have a biological substrate, and I think that's what it is. So why cheese? The reason is, if I take milk, milk has got a lot of water in it, and if I'm going to make cheese, I throw in something to curdle that solid, and you make a protein solid in it. That's all the casein. The water goes out along with the whey protein, and they sell that whey protein, by the way. It's just it's something discarded from the cheese industry. They put a nice label on it and sell it to bodybuilders. That's what whey is. It's just a cast off from the cheese industry. Then they have eliminated the lactose sugar, the whey protein, and all the water. What you're left with is protein and fat. And that protein is casein. It's dairy crack. This is the strongest, most concentrated form of casomorphins you can find, much stronger than yogurt or ice cream. Okay. You be the doctor. The patient comes into the doctor's office and presents with yellowed fingers, a chronic cough. He's been spitting up blood, and he's had gradual weight loss. What's going on? There's an empty cigarette pack in his pocket. Now, when I was in medical school, we would say, I see your fingers are kind of yellow. We should get a dermatologic consultation. The chronic cough can be dealt with by the pulmonologist. You're spitting up blood. Well, let's just wipe that away. You're losing weight. Let's eat more. And by the way, we sell cigarettes in the hospital gift shop. You could pick some up. Well, what should the doctor do? What we should recognize is these are all symptoms of smoking that is leading to what looks to me like lung cancer. And we have to intervene way before that cough ever begins. Okay, you be the doctor. The patient comes into the doctor's office with broken blood vessels on his nose. He's got an unsteady gait. He's got chronic marital problems that he's complaining about. He's got a history of cirrhosis. And he's had a number of arrests for driving while intoxicated. Well, in American medicine, I'm going to send him to the dermatologist who probably has an ointment for his nose. We'll send him to the neurologist to look at his gait. We'll send him to the psychologist to deal with his... No, we don't do any of that. We know. Doctors know what this is. This is alcoholism. And there's not a doctor in America who isn't clearly trained to recognize all those things and to refer that person not just for medical care, but to get off the offending agent. We know that. And we deal with it, some more effectively than others. But we don't just treat the symptoms. We will treat that cause. And doctors know they will send the patient to AA. They will not fool around. They don't say, just try to switch to beer and wine. We say, you can't drink anymore. We bring in the family. We counsel them. We bring in the kids. And we're strict. And we'll send that person to AA. We say, you don't have to like it. You have to go. Treat it like a drug and take this and do it. You're the doctor. The patient comes into the doctor's office. He's got gradual weight gain. He's got chronic constipation. He's got a high cholesterol level. He's got high blood pressure. He's got diabetes. What should the doctor do? Well, what the doctor does now is send the patient to a dietitian to try to cut out some calories, give the patient some remedy. Oftentimes, it's either a cathartic or it's fiber taken out of plant foods and concentrated in a bottle that the person pays for to add to juice or something to swallow more fiber. The cholesterol is treated with Lipitor, the most popular drug, the most often prescribed drug in the world, is not a treatment for an infective illness. It's not an AIDS treatment. It's Lipitor. It's a cholesterol-lowering drug. The most popular medication on earth is there to bring down problems caused by dietary excess. The high blood pressure is treated with one, two, or three, or sometimes four drugs. Diabetes, same story. People come to my office on 7, 8, 9, 10 drugs. What should the doctor do? The most common illnesses are the result of being hooked. They're the result of something cultural. Yes, tobacco, maybe alcohol, maybe drugs, but are unhealthy foods. And it's time for us to recognize that we can't just treat symptoms. We have to go to the cause, and that's where it is. If we don't do this, is this not true? The generation that is now in school, I'm talking about kids 12, 13, 14 years of age. Today, they are more out of shape than any generation in American history. Is that not true? They are more overweight. We are starting to see hypertension in kids. They're 16, they're 17. Doctors want to put them on drugs. They're already on diabetes drugs. People are looking at their cholesterols. They're worried. These were unheard of a generation ago. That has to end. We have to address the cause, and we must address it in our patients, in our friends, in our workplace, and in their families, and in our kids. If we don't do that, we cannot afford the consequences. But if we do that at sessions like this, and in all of the communities that we come from, we can revolutionize the health of this country. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. If anybody has a question, we've saved some time for Q&A if you have any questions, or if you have a comment that you'd like to make, or a rejoinder, or whatever. That's right. I can repeat the question. You said if you take a drug, will good and bad cholesterol both reduce? Typically, and this is not only true of drugs, but it is true with diet. And different drugs behave in different ways, by the way. But with regard to diet, bad cholesterol will drop, total cholesterol will drop, and good cholesterol will drop as well. And that's what we see. And sometimes people are concerned because they think my good cholesterol is falling, but the ratio is what counts. And the ratio improves. In other words, the bad drops more than the good. Do we track the statistical validity of the data that we collect? Oh, yeah, definitely. I didn't mention this, but everything that we do is always written up and it's published in peer-reviewed journals. And before the study that we're doing now with people with type 2 diabetes, you have to present your statistical plan to NIH before they write a check for you. And everything from the sample size to how you're going to handle data is all very carefully gone over. And what you're looking for is that the result is very unlikely. I know you know this, but you want to make sure that it's very unlikely to be due to chance, say a less than 5% likelihood that your results are due to chance, and that's what we go for. Yes. S, do you want to maybe tackle that? The question is, what happens to people over time? Because the studies I described are sort of on the short term. S, do you want to make a comment?
I think the question is about duration, and what I'll be talking about on Sunday is that the patients that we asked to go on a totally plant-based vegan-type diet for coronary artery disease, as I'm writing up a book for the public on this now, this is the year that they've now entered their 20th year. And I think what's so empowering in that particular subset of patients, and I'm sure it would be true of what Neil is discussing as well, is that these patients recognize that they have become the locus of control for this hideous disease. Not the cardiac surgeon, not the cardiologist, but they themselves, as the locus of control, are absolutely where this starts and stops. And this is so powerful, and that I think the fact that we now have this group out at 20 years is a testimony to that, and I hope that reinforces what you...
Great, thank you, S. I might just cite one thing. Dean Ornish's study that I mentioned earlier, I didn't present this in the presentation, but... he showed reversal after the first year, but he also tracked the people out for 5 years, and that was published in 1998 in JAMA. And the nice thing about it was they lost weight in the first year, and some of that, a little bit of that weight came back on, but the average weight after 5 years was still substantially below their weight 5 years earlier. In other words, you go on Atkins, you go on many of these other programs, and you lose weight, and then you rebound later. His patients never got up to their original weight, which is great. Question in the back?
I was wondering what you see is the difference between knowing the solution and the society that needs the changing, understanding and being able to actually make the change. What do you see in terms of, I guess, an advocacy position is needed to move from the step of basically the public not knowing to the public knowing? I mean, it's got to be something more than just knowing the answer.
How do we get this word out, you mean? How do we encourage people to change? What are the steps?
Sure.
It seems to me there might be a group of things, all of which are going on and simply need to go on as rapidly as possible. What I presented is sort of the beginning of it, in my view, which is to make a clear and honest case for why a diet change really is helpful. And also it's useful to know what its limits are. After that, I think there is an advocacy job to do, both with regard to the medical community and with regard to health organizations, scientific organizations, and certainly the lay public. And then finally, I think people have to also taste the food. They have to picture what it is so that vegan really means something wonderful. And that is happening now. It's been about 2 years since I heard anybody mispronounce the word. You remember that? You're a veg, vegan, whatever. People have figured this out, and we've still got a long ways to go. But Ann and Larry and people who are really serving this to people, or Mary's books and whatever, show people that it's great, it's easy, and you hear this too. I'd like to go vegetarian, but it sounds I don't cook. Sounds like a lot of work. It is no more work. I think it's no more work than a meat meal, and the cleanup is so fast because you're not trying to scrub all that caked goo off of your roast pan. So I think those things have to happen. I think the science must go forward. I think the advocacy must go forward. And I think you also have to just reach people, show them what the food is like. There's one other piece of this that I didn't talk about, but that we spend a lot of time doing. I think you should sue the bastards. And here's what I mean. This is a little bit off topic, but I think it was the year 2000 when the U.S. government was reformulating the dietary guidelines for Americans. We put in through the Freedom of Information Act for the resumes, the CVs. of the 11 members on that committee, and six of them had economic ties, especially to the dairy industry, but also the meat and egg industry. And that's just wrong. These are the people who are laying down the blueprint for what kids are fed in schools, for all federal and most private dietary programs. So we sued them. And we went to U.S. District Court in the District of Columbia, and it was kind of a knockdown, drag-out fight. But the bottom line was we won, and the court ruled that, in fact, these were these guidelines were produced outside of the transparent process that it should have been. And then you've seen these dairy ads, which are just shameless. Have you seen these dairy will cause you to lose weight? Isn't that incredible? Well, about a month ago, we brought a suit against all the big dairy manufacturers, and within about 24 hours, Kraft called us. And they were a defendant in the suit, and they said they wouldn't run those ads anymore. Could they be out of the suit? So they're out. But the others are still in, and we'll see how we do. And this past Thursday, we brought a lawsuit in District of Columbia because we want warning labels on milk cartons about lactose intolerance. I can't tell you how many people I have seen who say, I thought I had parasites, I was colonoscoped, I was tested, I was then diagnosed with irritable bowel syndrome, and finally some doctor after 2 or 3 years said, why don't you not drink milk for about 3 days? And their symptoms all go away. And if everybody knew all about how food affects them, we would have a healthier society. So we're now suing every dairy producer in the District of Columbia to put warning labels in. So we'll see how we do. We have an organization in which the doctors and the lawyers get along pretty well. So anyway, that's not exactly what you asked, but yeah, please.
I have a coworker whose father-in-law died of Lou Gehrig's disease, and it was a long, horrible year. But she did some research, and she thought that Lipitor triggered that. She had read that. Do you know of any connection?
The question was, well, I guess everyone heard the question, is ALS related to Lipitor? I'm not aware of a link. Anybody else? I think it's an important question you've asked, and I don't know the answer to it.
Yes, have you done any studies on hypothyroidism and diet and whether or not dietary corrections can make a difference in the disease?
Is there anybody talking on that subject this weekend? I'm not aware that they are. And I am not an expert in hypothyroidism, but I do hear of people talking about dietary links to it, and I hope that you find a good source of information about that. Anybody else have anything they want to jump in on with that? Okay. I strongly suspect that there are dietary links, and the reason I say that is we're seeing more and more of it, and I don't think it's just more attention to it. I think there is something going on. But anyway.
There is some information now available that they think that with the large number of psychopharmacology drugs that are being handed out readily for depression and so forth, that they're seeing an increase in the number of patients that are showing up as hypothyroid following the administration of these same agents, which I find very interesting.
Okay, could be. One other connection that might be worth noting is that there's a normal part of body biochemistry, which is that when you have a diet that's high in carbohydrate, I'm talking about healthy carbohydrate, the brain makes more serotonin, which is what Prozac does. And I've often wondered if you have people who are avoiding carbohydrates, either because they're afraid of them or because there is so much meat and other things stuffed into their diet that there isn't room for rice and starchy vegetables and the healthy foods, what they end up doing to their brain chemistry, and then as a result they're having other treatments for it that may have other effects.
Check. How does a basic person weigh the different types of studies that are thrown at them by the medical society? Because it seems like everyone has their own view of a particular study, and it's thrown at us. How do we weigh that?
I know what you mean, and there's kind of a common perception that it's one thing one week and another thing another week, and that sometimes things conflict. I don't think that research studies honestly conflict. I think the picture is quite coherent. Except when somebody tries a halfway measure. You'll hear vegetables and fruits prevent cancer. No, they don't. Yes, they do. No, you know what I'm talking about? Well, the diets that they're testing are not a low-fat, vegan, vegetable-rich diet. It's adding another vegetable here or there to an otherwise abysmal diet. Does it work? Doesn't it work? Does this supplement work? Does fish oil work? Does fish oil work in a person who's on a god-awful, meaty diet? You see what I mean? So, or is margarine better than butter? If you get them all out and you get onto a healthful diet, then you get away from that problem. But when we look at studies, we simply look at the results that they bring. And there has been a steady progression from observational studies. People who selected vegetarian diets on their own, for example, Seventh-day Adventists, where virtually everybody is health conscious, non-drinkers, don't use caffeine, don't smoke, but about half of them are vegetarian and half are not. So they're a great group for researchers to focus in on. And the vegetarians do better on most measures. And I mean substantially better, less diabetes, less weight problems, and so forth. And there have been a number of observational studies of this type, and that led people to do randomized clinical trials, like as we've been doing, where you bring in people who aren't vegetarian, never had a vegetarian meal in their life, and you assign them the diet. And then you measure and see how they do. And you have to do these things in a very careful way. But the results, happily, are very, very consistent. It's not like Atkins, where with Atkins, people will lose weight on Atkins, but about one-third of them, they're bad cholesterol, LDL, goes up, sometimes just through the roof. And then the long-term results for some, they do okay, for others they do terribly. It's very, very inconsistent and dicey. And almost everybody's losing calcium in their urine, so you get some benefit for a short period of time and all these terrible side effects. With the diets that we use, everything is better because, and by everything I mean you lose weight, your cholesterol falls, your blood pressure comes down, your diabetes gets better, because it's like taking your car and looking at the owner's manual and saying, you know, the exhaust has been bad for 6 years, and the acceleration has been rotten for all this time, and damn it, I thought I was supposed to put diesel in it, but it takes unleaded. And so you put in the unleaded, and everything gets better. The exhaust is better, the acceleration is better, the ride is better, everything is better. Your body's the same way. We're using the wrong fuel, you take it out, you put in the right fuel, you're not going to be immortal, but you're going to come as close to it as your genes are going to let you. Sure.
Oh, doctor, would you comment on the relationship between being a vegan and longevity?
Yes. And please jump in here if anybody else wants to tackle this. There have been a number of studies on longevity, although there have not been an enormous number, and the reason is they're hard to do. Longevity is waiting for, you know, the end of life. And the studies differ somewhat with the estimations of the added life that people get. But there are two findings that emerge. The first is that people on vegetarian diets clearly do live longer than people who eat meat. There haven't been, to my knowledge, enough studies of vegans to differentiate them from other kinds of vegetarians. The other thing is that you get more of a box shape of life. Typical life amongst people who are not eating in a healthful way, starting somewhere in midlife, you begin to decline. And your health gets kind of worse and worse and gradually erodes, and then eventually you're in the hospital, you take a lot of medications, and you die. When people are on healthful diets and have healthful lifestyles, you're pretty much okay, and at age 50 or 55 or 60 or 65, you don't expect to slow down, and then the end, when it comes, is fairly quick and precipitous. And so you see both a longer life and also a healthier life in the process. Yeah, I said, should the percentage of calories of fat be around 10%? Yes, except for one thing. I don't think you should count. Because sometimes people really don't know what their percentage of calories from fat is, and I don't think you should know. If you're not eating any animal products and you're not adding fat to anything and you're avoiding fatty foods, it's going to end up there, or maybe even lower. Now, S, I know you get into this, and John, I know you've been dealing with this for a long period of time. People will imagine that oils are healthful, or you need some fat in the diet, they'll say, well, what is olive oil? Olive oil is 10,000 olives. You throw away all the fiber and all the pulp and everything except for that oil, and you concentrate it and put it in a jar and put a label on, and I call it extra virgin or extra extra virgin or extra 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 virgin, and you sell it at a high price, and people think this is natural. It's a refined product. It's like sugar, where you take sugar cane or sugar beets and you throw it all away except for that sweetening part, throw that in a box. These oils are unnatural. There's no plant where it's got like a faucet on it for the oil to come out. So if people, and this is beyond what you asked, but if a person avoids those things, virtually all the vegetables are well under 10%. Fruits are, beans are, you know, 4% of calories, something like that, grains as well. So you'll be comfortably under there, but I hope nobody really counts. We have to count in research studies, but you don't have to. Okay. Why don't we stop at that point? I wish you an excellent conference. I want to say special thanks to Jeff and Sabrina for having me here. I really appreciate it. Good luck to all of you. Thank you.